Yali Madeth, everyone. I just wanted to start by putting up the Head Start portfolio up here, just because it's a really, really great place where you can go and see all the previous webinars that have been recorded. There's a lot of good resources that you can use on there. So that's just there, just in case anyone wants to note that down. This webinar has been created as an opportunity for parents to ask questions about returning back to school from tomorrow. In some cases, students won't be going back until the middle of the week. In other cases, there might be a phased approach. We know that it's very, very different for each and every school and each and every family. We wanted this to be here as a guidance, as a support, so feel free to ask any questions. No questions are silly questions. And we really, really hope that we can help support you in the best way that we can. We know that schools have been putting a lot of time in preparing in light of the government guidance, and it is important to follow your school's guidance. Please make sure that, you know, everything that we say is there as advice, but please do follow your school's guidelines and procedures to ensure a productive and safe return for students. We're really, really lucky today to have two great speakers join us and to answer some of your questions. Both are very experienced in the education field. Atifa has experience as a head teacher, school improvement advisor, and Ofsted inspector, whilst Alia is currently an assistant head teacher with over 10 years of experience. We're really grateful for both of them taking their time out of their busy day to join us, especially with the school starting tomorrow. We will be starting by answering some questions that have already been asked. And whilst these questions are being answered, please feel free to write your own questions in the comments box. So without further ado, I am going to start with our first question. And our first question is going to be answered by Atifa. And the question is, what can I do to help support my child's well-being in light of the recent changes in schools?
Thank you. Hello, everyone. I think in response to this question, the first thing to remember is that you've already been doing a really good job of caring for your child's well-being. From this, you'll have noticed that a child, a young person's reactions can vary according to their age, how they understand information and communicate, their previous experiences, and how they typically cope with stress. If your child is due to return, it would be beneficial to talk through how they're feeling and respond accordingly, offering lots of reassurance. So as you do this, it's advisable to model a calm tone of voice, smile to share real hope and optimism, listen to them, and really acknowledge their concerns and give them extra love and attention if they need it. This is a time to really boost their mood by encouraging them to think back to what they actually enjoy about school. It might be being with their friends, being with the teachers, assemblies, break times, a piece of work that they've particularly enjoyed doing. Help them to understand that the school may have new ways of doing things, such as not sitting so closely to their friends, but that the school are working really hard to keep them and their friends really safe. You could turn it into an adventure. Where possible, though, use information given by the school for a really coordinated response. Next, you could talk through how children can take responsibility themselves and actually look after their friends through this process. They can take responsibility by following the rules and procedures and helping others be able to understand them. Continue to support connections. If they haven't seen their friends, perhaps this is a time where you can arrange a telephone or video call with at least one friend who's also returning to school. This can help them to rebuild relationships and connections with their friends. Family routines are very important at this time. So encourage the children to prepare for school together. Get the equipment ready, organize clothing, so they feel involved and in control of the return process. Learning about emotions and feelings is really important. And I particularly have found tools such as the change curve are a really visual way of helping children understand the range of emotions that they could experience at this time, but also to understand that change is a natural cycle of life. Help them to recognize where they are in the change process. Reassure your child that there will be lots of staff that they can go and speak to if they feel anxious. And of course, remind them that you will be there at the end of the school day to collect them.
That's great. Thank you. And some really, really great tips and things that parents can do with their children before they go back to school. Thank you. Our next question, is my child's school safe? And Alia, can I ask you to answer that one, please?
Yeah, sure. So we all know we're in unprecedented times at the moment, and every school is going to be different with their approach and how they reopen schools. What parents can be assured of is that, you know, every school, every head teacher wants to protect the well-being of their staff and pupils. They will do their utmost best to keep their school safe and everyone in it. They will have followed the guidelines given by the government to do with health and safety. They will have developed their own risk assessments in terms of how they do the deep cleans, how they operate day to day. They would have spoken to unions and had some consultations with them. They would have tried to do different ways to reduce contact with each other. So that would be different staggered start and finish times, lunch times, break times. We all know that they're all having smaller class sizes now, so no more than 15 in each class. And of course, they'll have their own procedures and processes that they'll follow if someone was to get sick. They may have introduced one-way systems, so they will adopt different ways in ensuring that everyone is safe when their school opens.
Now, that's great. And I think to echo that, I think every school has been having a lot of meetings, a lot of like time putting these things into place. So I think we can rest assured that schools are ready for students to go back. Our next question, and the questions are up there on the slide as well. With 7 weeks of the academic year left, what is the learning going to look like? And Atifa, can I ask you to answer that question, please?
Sure. Again, it's really important to remember that the school staff, all of them, be it the principal, dinner ladies, caretakers, they will all be really looking forward to receiving the children and connecting with your child again. So a really positive note to start on. Remember that all the staff and the teachers in particular know your child well already. They've worked to ensure curriculum planning supports socialisation at this time and the well-being of children as a real priority. Teachers have been working to make adjustments to the curriculum and have planned activities that are age-appropriate, relevant, interesting, and engaging. Depending on your child's ability, though, learning will focus on activities that encourage curiosity, joy, wonder, and excitement. This is the job of education, and this is what teachers are particularly well-versed with doing. Learning can focus from reinforcing and consolidating concepts and really making sure that your child has a good grasp of foundational skills. At this time, the focus may be particularly on literacy and numeracy. So schools may focus on reading, different styles of writing, building vocabulary and oracy. These are really great opportunities to really build those foundational skills. Many schools will also use the current situation to focus on age-appropriate health education. Some teachers will look to broaden the learning experience through collaborative projects, such as challenging them to design new solutions to environmental or health issues, for example. Schools greatly value the emphasis they place on other subjects such as physical education, music, and the arts. So these will continue over time in some form. Many schools will also use this as an opportunity to build on your child's computing and digital literacy skills. Children have had a great deal of time to practice these skills. And I know that many schools will want to capitalize on that learning. Remember also that teachers are experienced at assessing the impact that their teaching is having on your child's learning. They will continue to use this information to plan your child's next steps so that he or she continues to develop. Many schools will be keen to acknowledge and recognise the value of all the learning that has happened at home. So all the cooking that's been going on, the cleaning, the gardening, and many activities will continue to build on this through the curriculum. So it's a really, really positive and powerful time to go back to school.
Thank you, Atifa. And yes, no, there's a really, really great insights. Thank you. Our next question, and I think this might be on a lot of parents' minds, will I be charged if I keep my child at home? And Alia, could you answer that one for us, please?
Yeah, sure. So the government is strongly encouraging children in all eligible year groups to return to school, unless, of course, they're self-isolating or shielding. But parents are not going to be fined if they choose not to send their children to school. So no, you won't be charged. They will not be fining you.
Great. Our next question. What benefits are there for sending my child back to school? And Atifa, if I can direct that one to you, please.
Sure. In some households, children may have lost their sense of a structured day a little bit, and a new structure will have formed and evolved. I know that's certainly what has happened in my house with my teenagers. Going back to school can help to reintroduce a routine, because schools by nature can help your children to return to a routine that was once familiar. And this in itself can bring a real sense of comfort, reassurance, and purpose to your child's day. If we think about the education provided by a school, it extends far beyond the teaching of academic subjects, as we all know, far beyond just the teaching of reading, writing, and maths. As children see their school friends in different year groups, schools can continue to enable your child to learn how to be with others outside of the family in a safe environment, and develop skills and attitudes such as learning how to socialise, share time, share attention. They learn how to manage their feelings and express themselves. They learn to be an effective team player, to develop leadership skills, all of these things that are necessary to be responsible citizens at any age and phase in life. So there are lots of benefits to sending your child back to school at this time.
Thank you. Our next question, will my child's class teacher be teaching my child? And Alia, if I could ask you to answer that one, please.
So there's no guarantee that your child's class teacher will be teaching them. And it's important that parents recognise this and don't expect this. There are many reasons for this. It depends on the numbers of children returning back to school, the needs of the different children that are coming back. But also it's important to remember that the teachers themselves may be shielding or self-isolating, or may have other reasons why they are not placed with your child. So it's also important to just warn your children, or just, you know, talk to them about the fact that their teacher may not be back, and that's okay if they're not back. But they will, of course, be looked after well. They'll be taken care of. The learning will still be as good as if it was their class teacher. You can be assured of that, that, you know, the class teacher will have passed on notes, done a handover, if it's not them in the class with the child. So parents shouldn't worry if that's the case.
Brilliant. Thank you. And I can see some parents are starting to write some questions on the chat. And I encourage everyone, if you have a question, then this would be a really good time to ask it now, just by typing it in the comments box. So the question is, how will PE and playtime differ to before the closure of schools? And Alia, can I ask you to answer that one?
Yeah, sure. So as far as possible, as much outdoor learning that can take place will be encouraged. Obviously, it's weather dependent, space dependent. Every school will be different, but schools will be encouraging as many classes as possible to spend time outside. In terms of actual PE or play times, the children, whether they're put into a pod or a bubble, whatever their new class essentially is going to be called, will hopefully be given a dedicated space that they can use for their play times, PE times. They will be non-contact times, so children will be encouraged to socially distance play games such as throwing a ball, catching it, where they can space themselves out. PE will still take place, but again, teachers will be very aware of how to keep the children socially distanced. They will make it as fun as and interactive as possible, bearing in mind that children cannot be too close together. So whilst PE lessons will take place and children will be given lunch times and break times, they will differ slightly in the fact that they won't be able to mix possibly with other children that they're used to seeing in their year group or in other classes in different year groups. They may be taken to a different space within the school to have their outdoor time. And that's just to reduce the risk of having everyone together and maintaining social distance.
Thank you. I think that answers that question really well. Our next question is for families who have siblings now at home. Do you have any advice for the mental health being and education for that child? So the child at home who is not going back to school, what advice could you give about the child that's staying at home now? Atifa, could I ask you to answer that one?
Sure. I think the first thing to say is continue doing what you've been doing really well. Build on what you've been doing with when all of your children were at home. That's the first thing to say. The second thing is perhaps you would want to make the child who is at home feel a little bit more special by spending a little bit more time with them or giving them an opportunity to do something that they wouldn't ordinarily do, just so that they feel as valued and as much that their learning is continuing as the other child who is going back to school. There are resources, a range of really good resources on mind education and young mind, and also the Anna Freud Education Center. And they have really, really good interactive videos, films, but also practical activities for families and parents to do with their children, but also for children to do by themselves. They might be good signposts for you to turn your attention to, depending on the age of your child.
That's great. Thank you. And some of the resources that are mentioned on the webinar today or some of the sites, we'll make sure we share those with you afterwards so you can visit them. The next question, I am not sending my children back as I am shielding my elderly parents who live with me, but I am concerned about them falling behind. As much as I do at home, I have two boys, year one and year two, and have to work, so I'm not doing as much as they would do at school. How will schools help children who join again in September but have missed things from the previous year? And I'm happy for either person to answer that question.
Yeah, I don't mind. So first of all, it's okay. If you feel you haven't done as much, do not worry at all. There is no expectation from schools for parents to complete everything that they have set for their children. And if you look at schools just generally as a whole, you will find that there are some schools producing 4 or 5 lessons a day for a child to complete. Others are just posting something on a Monday with a list of things that for children to complete. So, you know, the consistencies between the schools will be different. So there is no need to worry at all if you feel like you have not done as much with your children as you should have. There has been no expectation that all the learning will be carried out at home. Going forward in terms of September, schools will be very, very aware of the different stages that the children will be at when they return in September. For some of them, it will be the emotional well-being that needs to be the focus. For others, their children will be fine and it will be literacy or numeracy that they need to catch up on. But your teachers will do the best that they can for your child. They will know what your child needs after a few weeks of your child being back at school. Whether it's them doing some sort of revision from the previous year group, or whether it's starting new curriculum and incorporating the previous year's work with that, every school will be different. But what I would say right now is to not worry about where your child is in terms of falling behind. Focus on their well-being at the moment, keeping them comfortable, happy emotionally, so that the confidence is there when they go back to school. Because you've got to remember, for them, it will be very daunting going back to school. Things are different. It's not the school that they're going back to that they left when school's closed. It will be different. Their classes will be different. They may not even be in the same classroom as they were before. So focus on the well-being right now and not worry too much on where they are academically, because your teachers, your new teachers, will get them back to where they need to be.
I think that's excellent advice. Thank you, Alia. This next question is similar. Atifa.
Sorry, I was just going to say, just to build on what Alia has said, is remember that education is about more than just the maths, the literacy and passing exams. There are so many skills that the children can learn, and I'm sure they are learning just by helping you with cooking and cleaning and tidying and organizing. These are actually life skills, so it's a good time to focus on those. But the other thing just to say is, if you are concerned about your child's academic progress, is to turn to resources like the National Oak Academy, which is a government-run online school that has been set up specially for this period of time. And also the BBC's Bite Size website have put on additional lessons to build on foundational skills. And these are video clips and lessons that the children can engage in and work independently on. So if you are working, you can be assured that the children can self-manage their learning, self-assess, and direct their pathway. So these, again, are really useful skills in metacognition.
Great, thank you. And thank you to, as a lady who's written down some of the resources that you're saying as we're speaking, and I mean, that's really helpful for everyone. I'm making notes as well, so we can make sure that we can share those with all the parents, because I think it's resources like that are very, very useful to use in a time like this. So just to follow up with the next question, my daughter is in preschool and will start reception at a different school in September. I'm reluctant to send her back to preschool as I have a newborn. What can I do to ensure she is prepared to transition to start reception in September? And if I could pass that one to Alia first.
Yeah, so what I would say is talk to her about the fact that she will be going to a new school. Make her part of your plan. So, you know, packing her school bag, getting her uniform ready. Talk to her about what it will be like possibly when she is at school, all the great things that she'll be able to do, so that if she has got any anxiety about being in a new place, that can be eliminated if possible. But you also have to bear in mind that she will have spent a lot of time at home. These children have come out of school. They've gone into a bubble, so they're not engaging with Jamaat Khana, Beit Lilm, going out as much as they would normally be. So for them, it's really, really different. They're adjusting to a whole new way of life. And for them to suddenly then have to go back to school or start a new routine or be amongst people will be daunting for some of them. So it's really, really important that you make them part of that process, that preparation process. Talk to them about it. Engage with them, maybe show the school website, talk about some of the activities they may be doing. If you're by the school, you know, to have a walk around it if possible, show them the building so they get some sort of familiarity of what it is they will be doing in a few months or when it is time to start school.
That's great, thank you. And just to follow that up with a question that's just come in, just because we know that nurseries are opening as well. A parent has asked, just wanted to ask if the same safety measures apply for nurseries as well. What can we expect for nurseries with the reopening? And Alia, if I can direct that question to you.
Yeah, sure. So nursery have their own guidance. You will have some nurseries that are part of schools, which will follow the school's guidance that's been given to them. But what you can expect is they will be much more thorough in terms of their deep cleaning processes. So you might find that your nursery has a morning setting and an afternoon setting, and they've had to reduce the times, or they've said they won't be taking children in for lunch, just to allow them to have that deep cleaning process with the influx from the morning transitioning to the afternoon. So that's one way. But it's best to speak to your individual nurseries and find out what their processes are if you are worried, because like a school, every nursery will be different. It will be dependent on the space they've got available. Some nurseries may not be open to everyone, just depending on the amount of space. They may reduce your days, your hours. So it's best to speak to the individual nurseries.
Great, thank you. Another question. We have decided not to send our two children back to school until September. How do we focus on their emotional and mental well-being? And if I can direct that to Atifa.
Sure. I think I've already drawn your attention, I hope, to some of the resources that are being used in schools and across a range of international organisations. So that would be a good signposting. We can also share others with you. But the thing to remember here is that children are actually quite resilient. And I think interact with them, speak to them, because at school, there is less of a focus, I feel anyway, from working in schools on emotional and health and well-being. Hence the government making this a mandatory area of the curriculum from September, actually. But this is a really good time to focus on children's well-being and emotions. And it's not easy to do. And that's why the resources I've signposted you to are actually designed to support you as parents to be able to do that and actually pitch the conversation to your child's own emotional maturity.
Well, that makes a lot of sense. Thank you. There's a few questions that have come in about the logistics of the running of school every day. So I might just group them together and maybe you can answer them all together. One was around, do you think the smaller class sizes and changes to PE and playtime will continue into next academic year? And another one was around, would school times start in the morning and the afternoon be the same at the moment? And the last one, and I can remind you these as you're saying them, what would the maximum size of a pod be?
Okay, so the maximum size of a pod is 15. The government has said no more than 15 into a pod or bubble. Having said that, some schools have reduced that number. Some are sticking to 12, some have 8, 9. It just depends on the numbers that they're having come in, but no more than 15 will be in each pod or bubble.
And the next one was around the school times. Would the school times starting in the morning and afternoon be the same?
So every school's different in terms of their start and finish times. And depending on their procedures, they will have start and finish times that are different for different year groups, just to stagger the amount of people that are coming on site to school. So it's worth checking with your individual school whether the times have been changed. And if your child is going back tomorrow, it's likely that this will have been communicated to you already. So I would encourage parents just to double check school websites, newsletters, make sure they've read all the information that has been sent to them, because it is likely that school timings will be slightly different and they will be staggered.
Great. And the last one was about, and I know you spoke about this earlier, the smaller class sizes and changes to PE and playtime. Is that something that's likely to continue into the next academic year?
So the answer is we just don't know. We don't know where we will be in terms of the numbers of cases, what the government advice will be in September. Right now, the advice is for this academic year, this term. We don't know when years 2 to 5 are coming back into school, even though the government has said they would like them back in before the holidays. But again, it just comes down to the logistics and the capability of each school. Can they manage it? What their plans are? And as for September, I'm sure the government will give new guidance and guidelines for schools to follow. So it's a question of just watch this space, really, and just wait and see what happens.
Now, that's really helpful. I think it is a really uncertain period and we just have to be aware of that and just kind of see how things change with the current situation. So just following that, and it could be very similar to the answer you've just given. Will the school stay open during summer holidays to catch up for lost time? Is it something that we know? Is it something?
So in terms of classes and lessons, no, it will not be open. And, you know, we've all got to understand that teachers and head teachers, they've all got their own families too, right? So whilst they are at home and they're working, they're providing lessons, for them to come into the summer holidays may not be feasible. So that's a straight away no. The government has said they will not be open. However, for key worker children, we're still waiting to find out what the plan is for key worker children, whether the requirement will be for schools to be open just for them.
That's great. Thank you. I'm just checking that I haven't missed any questions. If there are any others while we're speaking, then please feel free to write it in the comments. I, love how interactive it is. And I think this is what we want from a webinar like this, because we want to make sure that we can answer all those questions and anxieties that parents might be having before going back. I had a few other questions around the logistics, which I think would be useful to answer here. I do recognize that it'll be very much a school by school basis, but I think it's still useful. Can I send my child back in after a couple of weeks of it being open? And Ali, can I direct that one to you, please?
Yeah, sure. So again, there's no yes or no answer to this, because every school will be different in their approach. Don't be surprised if your school says no, because the planning that they would have done and put in place will be based on the numbers of children that they know will be coming in. And of course, they will not want to contaminate, if I can use that word, their pods or their bubbles by having children come in and out. Once that pod is set, it's only for those children and for that teacher to be a part of. You've also got to remember that in terms of social distancing, the routines they will have put in place, the space allocated to individual pods or bubbles will be set based on the numbers that they know of right now. So every school will be different, and it's important that if you do change your mind and you do want to send your child in, is to call your school and check with them first. I wouldn't turn up on the day and just send your child in, because they will not be ready for you. They will not be expecting you. Always call in advance and check, because every school will be different.
That's great. And I think just being at the point where children are starting to go back in now, I think it's really good to be aware of your school's policy. Make sure you're checking up on that. Make sure you're having those conversations, even if you decide not to send your child in right now. Another question to follow that, Alia. Will parents be able to enter the school?
Okay, so schools want to reduce the amount of adults or people on site. So it's likely that they will not be encouraging parents to enter the school office area or the administration area. I would suggest that if you do need to speak to your teacher or anyone in the office, is to call or email where possible. They may have a special waiting area for parents that do need to enter the school office, but if it can be done via phone or email, that's the best way. They need to reduce the amount of people on site. That's for your children's well-being, for staff well-being, for everyone's well-being, to maintain social distancing.
Great, thank you. And there's another question that's just come in, which I think is a really important one. What would be the key questions you would encourage us to ask the schools before sending children in? And this is from a parent whose daughter's class doesn't start until 15th of June, so has a bit more time just now. So that was, what would be the key questions you would encourage us to ask before the schools reopen? And if I can direct that one to Atifa.
Sure. I think the first thing is a question around reassuring yourselves about the safety of your child. So questions around safety, so that you feel reassured that physically sending your child back to school would be an appropriate thing to do. The second area I would ask about if I was a parent would be around well-being and re-socialisation into a group of, you know, into a group with other students. So how are the school actually going to do that proactively so that it supports the child and doesn't exclude them or intimidate them in any way? Sometimes groupings that the children are not familiar with can be threatening and cause anxiety unnecessarily. So it would be really helpful to get some reassurance around that. And then thirdly, around curriculum and learning. So to really better understand where the focus of learning is going to be, what the priority is going to be, and how the school are going to assess your child so that learning begins from your child's starting point, so that learning can accelerate and the children can continue to make progress. That I'm sure will be the intention of every school, but I think a reassurance around that would be helpful.
No, that's helpful. Thank you. And Ali, I don't know if you had anything else to add to that or
No, I think Atif has answered that really well, but also just to read the guidance that's sent from schools. A lot of the questions will already be answered through communication they may have sent, either through the website, through newsletters. If the school's not opening till the 15th of June, give them a week or so to get their head around things, set things up in motion before you start questioning about what their plans and procedures are going to be.
Great, thank you. And this question's come through a couple of times. Do you suggest to send my child to school as I am currently shielding an adult at home, a vulnerable adult? And what will be the loss to their education if they stay at home? So that was, do you suggest I send my child to school even if I'm currently shielding an adult at home?
I think that's very much going to be dependent on how you feel. But just through today's webinar, I know that Alia and I and Rabia have all reiterated the importance of children being at school and all of the things they'll gain. So if you can look at it from a positive perspective and be reassured that schools would not be reopening if the government didn't feel that schools could safely put in place measures to support the wider community. Rabia, can I just also say that in terms of to the parent whose child starts on the 15th of June, if I could just ask, as a head teacher, one of the things I used to find is that we used to send out information that we would take quite a lot of time over preparing in terms of clarity, consistency, to a particular standard. If I can really urge all parents to read the information that's coming from school first and to really think about why schools are saying, why your child's school is saying what it's saying. A school down the road might be doing something completely different and taking a very different approach. But I just think I'd like to reassure parents that head teachers speak to each other all the time, and the local authorities work very hard, regardless of whether a school is a maintained school or an academy school, to bring a coordinated approach to whatever it is that's going to be rolled out, but to be rest assured that head teachers will look at their school community and liaise with governors to make sure that the decisions taken for that immediate community are the right ones. So please read the information or look on the website, whichever channel and mode of communication your school has chosen. Please try and follow that as closely as you can in the first instance.
No, that's really good advice. And I think that's something for all parents to do, whether they're going back into school or not. So thank you. Another question's just come in. Is there anything we can think about in terms of reducing contamination into the home from school? And Alia, can I direct that one to you first?
Yeah, sure. So schools are encouraging, if your child has any stationery that they like to use or will be using, that parents send this in from home and it stays at school. Schools do not want things brought into school and then be taken home each day. They're trying to reduce that as much as possible. If your child has not been told to bring in any stationery, the school will provide it, but it will stay in school. In terms of other items, school uniforms, if your child's been asked to wear their school uniform, it's really important that they have a fresh, clean, new uniform that's put on them every single day. And I can understand how this may be difficult, but it's important that if you've only got a limited amount of uniform, that it does get washed daily. Schools will be understanding if you need to send the child into something similar that's not quite school uniform at this point in time. Some schools have even asked school uniform not to be worn, just to give that flexibility to parents so that they can wear fresh new clothes daily. In terms of school bags, again, some schools will be asking them to be brought in and then for them to be left at school and not taken home. You may be used to your child bringing home a reading book daily. That may not happen, just to reduce contamination. The only thing that I would say that should be brought in daily and taken home daily is your child's water bottle, because that can be washed at home, it can be refilled and sent back in. So whatever you can do to reduce any contamination in terms of stationery or bags or clothes, it'd be really helpful if the children could be sent in with new clothes daily and leave items at school that they will need daily.
Brilliant, thank you. Another question about learning. My child is not in reception year one or year six. Why isn't my child's year group not being selected to go back in? And can I direct that one to Atifa, please?
Sure. I mean, the government have decided which year groups will go back first. And having spoken to the unions, those decisions are largely based around what's going to happen in the following year. So the year one children going back because year two exams are looming, the year two SATs exams, those schools that are doing them. So it's really the precursor to the year of the exam. So that is the government's reasoning for sending the children back. I think that as the lockdown eases, different schools will make different decisions around which year groups can and can't go back. But I think the bigger thing to think about here is not to be stuck with whether your child is going back or not, but to focus on the fact that learning can still continue. And learning can still continue in the ways that we have outlined just in the short time that we've had for this webinar, but also go to the resources that the government has put on so that your child can continue their online learning. I think just focus on the learning element as opposed to the physical, being stuck with the physical element of is my child going back to school or not. Learning can happen anywhere. It can be exciting. It can be fun. It can be joyous. The children are naturally curious. So I think as parents, let's take a moment to focus on all of those wonderful things.
Thank you. And this question follows the previous one, and I think you've answered elements of this already. Is home learning being continued for my reception year one or year six child who will be not returning to school? And if it isn't, what can I do? I know you've given us some resources already, but I just wondered if there was anything else that you wanted to add.
Sure. So as Alia has said, learning will continue for different children in different stages, and different schools will have a very, very different approach. It's quite interesting to watch, actually, how schools are responding, and many are being very, very creative. If I can signpost you, I've recently worked on compiling and curating a set of global resources through the Aga Khan Development Network. So if I can signpost parents who are interested to the Aga Khan Education Services website. On there, we have curated a list of resources that can support you as parents in terms of academic learning, but also psychosocial and emotional well-being resources. We hope that you find those useful and interesting. I just want to reiterate, they are not UK-centric. They have been pulled from around the globe. And I think that they are really quite interesting. And what they certainly do is enable you to support your child to think about learning, not just from a school perspective, but in terms of a life perspective. So if you do have an opportunity, please feel free to use those resources.
Great, thank you. Another question that's just come through on the chat. And I don't know if this is, we don't have a solid answer to this, but what is the plan for other years to go back to school? So other years, then reception year one and year six. And Alia, can I send this question to you, please?
Yeah, so the government would like all the other year groups to go back and have at least 4 weeks or 1 month of learning at school. But again, we don't know if this is going to happen. Every school will be different in terms of what they can accommodate and what they can't. It might be that reception one and six, their term ends early so they can accommodate the other year groups. It may be that your chosen school will say, no, we can't have the other year groups in. It just depends on individual schools.
Great, thank you. This is a question related to COVID symptoms. A student in the same pod as my child from next week, let's say, has developed symptoms. What would happen to that pod? And Atifa, if I can send that question your way.
Sorry, if a child has developed symptoms?
Yes, in a pod, what would happen to that pod?
Okay, the schools have been doing a great deal around risk assessments and adding addendums to their health and safety policies. So in the first instance, that child would probably be sent home and procedures followed accordingly. And then information relayed to the parents of the other children. I mean, again, it's difficult to say what individual schools will do, but the safety of the children and the staff teaching that pod would be paramount. Other students in that pod may also be sent home.
Brilliant, thank you. And Alia, was there anything that you wanted to add to that one?
So as part of government guidance, schools have been told to have an isolation room where possible. So if a child is unwell, they will most likely be sent to the isolation room and you will be asked to collect your child as soon as possible. So it's important that parents are made available during their time that the child's at school so they can come and pick up their children. But also it's important that if your child is unwell, that you do notify the school. Let them know because you don't know what it could be. And I'm sure many parents would want to know if someone else's child was unwell and their child was in the same class, they would want to know about it. So it's important to keep the school informed.
Now that's great. I think transparency with everything is going to really help everyone involved, the schools, the parents, the other families. With the summer holidays coming up, any advice or tips for dealing with childcare issues during the summer holidays with no holiday clubs, no grandparents' help? Is there anything that you could advise or any resources that you could share?
I would just like to signpost back to the resources that we've had the privilege of curating as part of the Aga Khan Development Network. There is a wealth of information that we have managed to curate, and we've actually tried as much as possible to test those as both parents and educators. So that would be a good place to turn to. So again, the Aga Khan Education Service website would have those on their site, but also basic things that you're doing at home. So as a parent, setting small challenges and targets, just helping with everyday life skills. Also, the National Oak Academy, as I've already signposted to, BBC Bite Size. There's lots. There really is lots.
Yeah, I know there's loads out there, and we'll definitely try and share those resources with people that have attended the webinar today. Another question, which is very dependent on different schools, I think, as well. How will the changes of children coming into schools affect key worker children who have already been in schools? And Alia, if I could send that question your way, please.
Okay, so again, it's very different depending on which school your child goes to. Some schools will keep their key worker children in their same bubble because of the way they're approaching opening for the other year groups that are coming in. Some will have those key worker children join their year groups. So again, it's important just to check with your individual school. It really, really depends on the way they're approaching opening. We know that some schools are doing a phased approach. Some are going in and only just doing half days. Some are doing full days, but maybe just one day a week, building up to 5 days over the next 5 weeks. So please check with your individual schools.
Right, thank you. Another question that we've got here, and I think we've only got time for a couple more questions. So if you do have any questions, please write them in the chat now so that we can answer them. If we don't have a chance to answer your question, we will be sending answers to any unanswered questions through email afterwards. But I'm aware that we're coming to the end of the webinar. If children are in a pod in school, are they able to hang out with them outside of school? Would they be able to spend time with them outside of school? I don't know if there's any guidance or anything that's been shared about this. And if there isn't, that's completely fine as well. Alia, can I point that question to you, please?
Yeah, so outside of school, there won't be any guidance for schools to be giving out or to follow. You would just have to follow the usual government guidelines on social distancing and contact. So schools will be given guidance by the government of what they can do in school, out of school, parents will need to follow the national guidance that's been given on social distancing.
Great. And I'm going to end with one last question, which is around home learning, but I think an important one just to reassure parents. How do I know that my child is learning anything through home learning or through anything that I'm doing at home? Is there a way that I can know? And can I pass that on to Atifa, please?
Sure. I think be kind to yourselves. Learning happens all the time in all kinds of situations. And I think as parents, we know that. But when we go into educator mode, I think sometimes we worry that they're not actually learning specifically what we had intended them to learn. Be kind to yourselves and just really believe that learning happens all the time. It doesn't matter if what you intended isn't actually learned. I can absolutely assure you that something else will be learned. There's a lot of learning in failing. There's a lot of learning in then picking yourself up. There's a lot of learning in figuring out how to motivate yourself so you have a productive hour or a productive day. There's lots of learning. So please don't pinpoint learning just to what you can tick in a tick box. Let's be adventurous and open. As mums and parents, we know that learning happens all the time.
I think that's a fantastic note to end on, because I think it's so important. I think it, you know, in a time like this, to be kind to yourself, to make sure you're doing the best that you can, making the best of the opportunities that you have at home, those non-traditional learning activities as well. So I think that's really, really important. So thank you, Atifa. I just wanted to take this opportunity to just say thank you so much for spending your time with us today, for answering all the questions and just giving that support to parents before going back to schools tomorrow for some of us. And also a big thank you to the parents that have joined as well and for asking those questions. Because I think it's, you know, sometimes those questions are what other parents are thinking. And I think on a shared platform like this, it's a really good opportunity for everyone to share that information together. So thank you. We will be sharing those resources that have been mentioned during the webinar and send you the website links as well. And hopefully those will be useful. If you do have any more questions, please feel free to reach out to us. I just wanted to take another opportunity just to explain about Head Start. I know I started by talking about this, but I just wanted to make sure that people know where they can find the webinars that have already been done and also this webinar itself. On our Head Start homepage, on the homepage itself, if you scroll down to the bottom, the gray screen here that you can see with the little videos, that's where you'll be able to find the videos that are recorded. If there's an area that you're more interested in, such as early years or primary, secondary or apprenticeships, you can use the website to go to those particular areas, and there's other resources there. If you do have any questions, you can contact us at akeb@iiuk.org, and the email address is there on the screen for you just now. We will be following this webinar with a survey, and we'd really appreciate it if you can complete it. And it should only just take 1 to 2 minutes of your time, but it's really helpful in helping us prepare for future webinars. Our next primary webinar, just for parents who are on the call who want to attend it, it's all surrounded around arts and crafts. It's about using a creative curriculum within home learning and how we can ensure that's inclusive for all learners. And so the link is there, and we'll paste that in the chat just now. So once again, a big thank you to everyone who's joined today. And a thank you to Atifa and to Alia for your time today on the webinar and all those questions and strategies that you've given to parents. Thank you. And Yali Madet.